Good evening, everybody. I think we're all ready to begin now. Glad to see some people staying on for the rest of the program this evening. We're going to start off with the Mahoosuc Music Makers Brass Quintet. We're delighted to have them here, and they're going to play some music that you may find familiar. So we'll see what they're going to give us. Let's go.
By Rodgers and Hammerstein, and now we'll give you You'll Never Walk Alone, and then we'll go into some of the old-time favorites.
Jack.
of these are going to need introductions, so we're just going to go for it. First of all, let me take a moment to introduce us. On the tuba here is Brendan Bass. On trombone is Ellen Whitney. French horn is Jane Chandler. Trumpet is Brian Dunham. And I'm Nancy Morris.
Thank you. Thank you.
Test the time.
If they had any.
This is going to be our final number, and it's Tiger Rag.
Sponsored and lecture by Robert Pike, and he, of course, had already published his two most famous books, Spiked Boots and Tall Trees, Tough Men, and they'd made a real hit in the market for logging, lumbering, and folklore and all kinds of other fields, and the society sponsored this. I think it was held at Bingham Gymnasium. Bingham Hall at that time. It would be Bingham Hall by 68. And it was a very popular thing. And I think one of the first major fundraisers of the society at that particular time. Robert Pike died in 1997, right? 1997. 3 years ago Monday, she says. Okay. And we're delighted to have his daughter here to tell us something about his life, to read some of his works, and I don't know what else she's going to do, but we'll let her see what happens and go from there. So without any further ado, Helen Pike.
How many of you know your Bible stories? Remember anything? Remember about the Pool of Bethesda where everyone sort of sat around there on the edge waiting for the waters to move? I kind of feel like you're way far away from me. And if you all want to move up a little bit, now would be a good time to do that. Maybe if I talk loudly enough, you can hear me. That might help too.
Don't do the back of my bald head.
Right, you're safe.
Deputize Lee, I met just before I left to go take a rest in the striped shirt as my
my back row scholar, if my voice drops off, I want you to raise your hand and tell me to speak up. Okay, is that a deal? Okay. The Brass Quintet very graciously played Little Brown Jug, which was one of my father's favorite songs, and I wish you had played at his memorial service, because you gave it a great rendition. The songs that I grew up hearing, I recently realized, all had to do with some aspect of drinking in one way or another, and it seems to me that there was a lot of drinking that went on in the lumber camps. And in fact, in Spike Blues, my father devotes a whole chapter to rum running, which up here on the borderlands of Canada was something that was done frequently and easily. I wanted to give you a little bit of an idea of what life was like in 1956. My father had just gotten a full-time job teaching at a small college on the Jersey Shore that had been a junior college called Monmouth Junior College. And the trustees bought a building that's the only Versailles replica in the United States, which was fitting for my father since his PhD is in French from Harvard University. He became chairman of the foreign language department. And in that year of 1956, there was a baby boom. And those of you that are good at math, you will figure out that how old I am. And on August 9th, I was born. And I was 10 pounds and 1 ounce, and they nicknamed me the giant pike in the hospital. My father thought that was just a great load of fun and somehow was fitting to have a daughter be named that. About 18 days later, my father got this rejection letter from Little Brown down in Boston to his agent. And I came across this when I started archiving my father's papers. And here it is, August 27th, 1956. Dear Mr. White, Mr. Pike has some entertaining tales to tell, and he tells them with considerable flair, but I'm sorry to report that we don't feel that a book which lacks dramatic cohesion, as this one does, would do very well. It's hard to see a pattern or a narrative line here that would hold the reader's attention over so long a span. We are very glad, however, to have seen this, and thank you very much for the chance to see at it. We are returning it under separate cover. I can only imagine that this is probably a bit of a blow to my dad, because this is a book that he had labored on and wanted to tell and share with the world at large. He had begun collecting these stories, I guess, probably when he was being raised by Harley Pike, his uncle, his father's brother. And when it came time for him to go to college at Dartmouth University, at Dartmouth College, he became a surveyor as a summer job in the woods and met many of these loggers and rivermen there, working for the Brown Company. And he then came back over successive summers, and in between his teaching job, he would come back to these north woods and would spend time with people that he knew in Maine or northern New Hampshire or northern Vermont. And sometimes he'd work the woods with them or he'd work their farms, and he would keep these notes down. I haven't found these diaries per se, but I have found the raw stories that he tried to sell individually to what we today would call pulp magazines. And so there's a photograph that I donated to the Waterford, Vermont Library of my dad behind his typewriter, which was taken about 1956, and I believe in anticipation that this book would sell, and it didn't. So my father decides teaching in the summer and teaching night school and took on tutoring jobs to teach kids how to speak French or Spanish or Russian. Saved enough money and went to a private printer in St. Johnsbury and had Spike Boots printed. And I think some of you here might have some of those early editions. There were 500 of them in soft cover. And that book sold rather well, to his surprise. And he went and saved some of that money and earned some more money and then printed 1,000 copies in hardcover with a gold embossed Spike Boots on the cover of those. And the book then went out of print until 1987, when Yankee in Dublin, New Hampshire, approached my father, and at that time they were diversifying, and they wanted to reissue the book. And that's when it came to be brought back into the public again for the first time with photographs. And then they They divested themselves of the book publishing business, and the copyrights came back to us. And 2 years after Dad passed away, the Countryman Press approached me and asked me if I would like to see this book come out again, because they were anxious to diversify their book line. And so I started this journey of going through my father's papers and looking for things and trying to figure out what kind of a life my father had before I was born, and what led him to write these books and to tell these stories. And it's been, so far, a rather gratifying adventure to solve some of the mysteries of my father's life. And so some of the things I have here to share with you I feel particularly sentimental, I think, about sharing them here, because it was here that my father turned out and filled the entire auditorium. I came with my mother to hear him speak at Bingham Hall. And he had a movie that he showed, and I came across a letter that he wrote to the president of the Historical Society at that time, in which he specifically asked for a microphone because my father had a very low voice and couldn't speak without a microphone very well for people to hear him. And so I thought, I'll take questions and answers afterwards, but I wanted to share some of these letters and some of the favorite passages from this book that are stories that were part of my bedtime stories growing up. And so the first thing I wanted to share with you is the story about, it takes place in Maine, for those of you who hold Maine near and dear to your hearts. And it comes towards one of the end chapters here in Spike Boots. If any of you know where Chained of Ponds is, that's where this story starts off. About a young man and his last, the family name is Willits. It was when he put his canoe down into Chain of Ponds after the portage from the Kennebec that Willits had felt it first, a curious sensation that irritated him because of its very elusiveness. It could not be explained or analyzed, but all day long it stayed with him and bothered him. It wasn't fear, it wasn't even uneasiness, though a man might have a reason to feel uneasy at being alone in those wild forests of northern Maine. It seems to me I've been here before, he muttered to himself as his flashing paddle drove him northward up the lakes. And yet, God knows, I never have. But when I hit that old Indian trail, I could have sworn I had seen it 100 times before. That baffling sense of familiarity of his wild surroundings stayed with him all that day. And when, at 6 o'clock, he thrust his boat gently up onto the shale at the head of Chain of Ponds and stared the black opening in the thick spruce that marked the beginning of the long carry to Parmacini Lake, it had begun to affect him physically. His head was feeling light, not the lightness caused by fever or fatigue, but a kind of reckless exaltation that had no sense or reason behind its origin. It must be the weather, Willits thought. I've never seen such a hot day in April, not this far north. A brief smile lighted on his lean, dark face. That's a good one, he muttered. This far north, and last summer was the first time I was ever up here. He sat in the canoe for a moment, his eyes fixed on the old trail that led up the steep bank, but in his mind he was reconstructing a scene with his father that had taken place a few days before. The old man stood in front of him, tall, lean, slow-eyed, his heavy hair as black as a crow's wing in spite of his 80 winters. Last summer, the aged professor had said, you were up in Quebec and northern Maine. I do not understand why that country should attract you so. I have never been there myself, of course, and though I have never told you before, when you first began to display these Daniel Boone tendencies of yours, your grandfather Nathaniel was very insistent that I let you go anywhere except up there. But your grandfather is dead, and you are old enough to know your own mind, so I made no objection last summer, nor do I now. I wonder what made Gramp feel that way, Willits asked curiously. The professor shrugged. I asked him, and he would not say. I know that years ago, before I was born, he had been up there himself. But what he did or saw there, I do not know. Only it must have been a very wild country then. Willits laughed. It's still a wild country, Dad, he assured him lightly. Of course, I came through only a little piece of it last summer when I came down from St. Augustine with Flint in his canoe, but I can tell you it hasn't changed. Willits remembered that conversation as he sat there in his canoe at the head of Chain of Ponds, and in his hip pocket he fingered the letter from Flint, with whom he had paddled down Parmacini in the McGalloway the year before. Flint wrote that the square tails were biting and that Willits would be welcome to come up and stay at his camp on Long Pond. So here he was. Only, instead of having chosen the sensible road up the McGalloway as far as there was any road, and proceeding from there by canoe, some strange quirk, some atavistic desire for adventure had inspired him to go around by chain of ponds. He was 25 years old, this young Willits, lean, sinewy, and a trifle saturnine. For his boyhood days, he had possessed a marvelous facility for picking up wilderness lore. That fact had never been so plain to him as it had the preceding summer, and the discovery had pleased him. That was one reason he had chosen to come by this roundabout route, just to prove that he could do it without any guide or any other help. And he had done very well so far, he told himself, as he sat in the stern of his canoe and stared at the opening of the overgrown and little-used portage. Not many men, even woodsmen, who were unused to the country, could have driven their canoe straight as an arrow into that old portage, he told himself. But he had done it as easily as if a lighthouse had been there on the shore to beckon him. It was youthful pride in his success, combined with the heady intoxication brought on by the unseasonable weather, that urged him on to the folly he now committed. For by rights, he should have made camp at the head of Chain of Ponds and waited until morning before starting the 7-mile carry to Parmacini. But now he decided to push on and get to Flint's camp that night. He could reach Parmacini by 8 o'clock, or 9 at the most, and he knew the way from there. He had been over it only once, but for Willits, once was enough. He put one hand on the gunwale and half rose to his feet, only to sink back again as that eerie feeling that had oppressed him all day long suddenly pressed upon him like something palpable. Damnation, he said out loud. I'd swear I've stepped out of a canoe here 100 times before. He shook his head impatiently and looked at the sky to see whether any danger threatened there. Little white clouds were slowly dragging their soft bellies over the spruce-clad border mountains, but there was no storm brewing anywhere. An unusual hush hovered over all the forest. But if that seemed a little unnatural, Willits told himself, there was nothing ominous about it. He swung the 16-foot canoe onto his padded shoulders and started briskly up the trail, looking like an immense green beetle stalking along on two legs. The dense spruces swallowed him up. He found the trail in bad condition, almost impassable in places. It was overgrown with brush, full of mud holes and slippery stones. And about halfway, he came up to a steep rise, which he sweated and scrambled for what seemed to be miles before he finally reached the crest. There was no breeze in the silent forest, and when he reached the top of the divide, hot and panting, he sat down on a fallen tree trunk to rest his weary muscles. Before he started on again, the last red edge of the sun had sunk out of sight to the west. Then, as always in those latitudes, came a period of twilight. But though Willits put his best foot forward, the trail was so bad that he did not reach the lake until night had quite fallen. Night, a warm curtain of black velvet shot through by a million pulsating stars. Willits did not know that the dam at Little Boy Falls at the foot of Parmacini Lake had gone out with the ice that spring. He knew only that he was in a hurry to get to Flint's camp, so he came paddling down the center of the narrow lake in the star-shot darkness, paddling fast, intent on getting to his destination. He was still half a mile above the falls when he noticed a small campfire on a long point of land that stuck out into the lake like a crooked finger, its tip crowned by the black outline of an immense pine tree. Indian Point, thought Willits, and what can a man be doing in such a remote place? But he was in a hurry. Indeed, he was in such a hurry that he did not even stop to eat since noon, and when his darkly gleaming paddle had driven him swiftly past the fire, he promptly forgot about it. A few hundred yards further on, he was surprised to feel the speed of his canoe suddenly increase. Thinking his senses were playing him a trick, he held his paddle suspended in the air for a moment. There was no doubt about it. He was being drawn ahead by an invisible force. Willits looked up and around him, then a little frightened, and more than a little puzzled. To his surprise, the shores of the lake had narrowed in on him. He was already in the river above the dam a few bends away. But that was impossible, he told himself, for any such current to exist here. Then in the starlight, he saw the first of the white water, and he knew that something was wrong, though even yet he did not guess what it was. But he knew that the dam must be just ahead, and he decided to chance the rapids as far as the carry. He drove on his paddle to give the canoe steerage and was about to enter the flurry of white rock-toothed water when, To his astonished vision, another canoe appeared just in front of his own. It was a birch bark, and in its center knelt a woman. An Indian, Willett's guessed, by her clothing and the two long glossy braids of black hair that hung down her back. The woman, if a woman it was, turned the upper half of her body so she faced him and held up her left hand in a mute but imperious warning to come no farther. Then, before his startled eyes, her frail craft shot down into the white smother and vanished. Automatically obeying her gestured command, Willett drove his canoe over against the right bank just in time to escape being sucked down into a raging quarter mile of rapids that he had never seen before. "Dam went out," he muttered blankly, understanding at last. "But that woman, in God's name, it must have been a ghost." The cold sweat of fear came out over all the man's body, and he trembled violently. He thought for an instant of searching for the woman, but he realized that such a hunt would be futile. Indeed, it would be impossible until daylight. He thought of the long carry ahead of him, and then he remembered the fire on Indian Point. Numbly, his mind filled with wonder at his miraculous escape, Willett turned and went back up the lake. A dozen feet from the foot of the huge pine tree, the small fire still flamed and reflected from a large boulder that acted as a backlog. Willett, shoving his canoe's nose silently into the sand, let out a hail. "Come on in, son," a large voice invited him, and Willett came. Though he had never been introduced to him, he recognized the ancient man who advanced to meet him. 40 years before, old man Levitt had been dubbed Maine's best guide, and if someone else now held the title, it was because, close to 80 years old now, the old man had retired from competition. "I'm on my way to Flint's," said Willett, "but if you don't mind, I'll camp here tonight with you." "I just saw a ghost," he finished, laughing shortly. Instantly, the old man was all attention. "What do you mean, a ghost?" he demanded. "This is April. What kind of a ghost, and where did you see it?" "You want to find out more about the ghost, you'll have to read some proofs." I learned the craft of my father's knee, you'll have to forgive me. One of the curious things that has happened along the way have been other writers that have contacted my father or have attributed their desire to write for a living to him. I think probably one of the men who's been most generous in this is Howard Frank Mosher, if any of you have read any of Mr. Mosher's writings. He contributed a piece that was read at my father's memorial service. Then this past March, I got a call from a writer in Vermont, also in Vermont, who called me up and told me the story that he was in the midst of writing a book. Actually, he was in the process of being edited. And it was inspired by reading Tall Trees, Tough Men, and it was specifically prompted by coming across a picture of Ginseng Willard. And this is Ginseng. And Ginseng was quite a man in Guildhall, Vermont. And this prompted a midlife crisis and a search for the meaning of death and what happens when we die and what it takes to bury us. And he wanted to know if he could use ginseng in his book. And so I said if he sent me the book, I'd read it and then decide if this is something that my father would want to be associated with. And to my utter amazement, it's a very clever, very noir, very comic take on all the things that happen and all the people that are involved in helping us get through our final passage of life. And the book is called Round Trip to Deadsville, and it comes out next month from Chelsea Green Publishing. And I gave them permission to use ginseng. And I'm going to tell you how my father, old Vern Davison, who's the narrator for this book, introduced Dad to Ginseng Willard, and I'm going to read the passage from here that tells you why I have a dead man on my chest. "Come on out and see my dance hall, the Bobcat," he said, and led the way across the yard to a long, low building that bore over its portal a painted likeness of a Canadian lynx. Inside, over the door leading from the vestibule to the hall, was a monster-mounted lynx. "That's a bay lynx," said old Ginseng, "and not a real bobcat. But people down here ain't familiar with lynxes, so I call the hall the Bobcat, and that's the reason. I caught this fellow right over there in a swamp. He was a monster, too. He weighed almost 40 pounds. The floor of the Bobcat was a very good one, but old Ginseng told us he had lost money on the enterprise and that no dances had been held there for several years. I built it 10 years ago, he said, for my son-in-law, who couldn't seem to find anything to do. I'm too old to run such a place myself, and besides, I had to be away a lot. But the demon rum got too strong for the manager, and the second week, with over 200 couples present and no orchestra appeared, none having been summoned, so I finally closed it up. I'm hoping to fix it up and put in a Victrola and let people come in for a dime apiece and dance as long as they want. It's the best dance floor in the North Country. What's that thing in the corner? My father asked, going over to look at a long rosewood box lying there. It looks like a coffin. It's a coffin, Mr. Willard affirmed. I built it myself out of a couple of grand pianos. I slept in it 2 years just to get used to it. Yes, that's my last overcoat. I made up my own epitaph, too, he went on. Maybe you'd like to hear it. Old Ginseng Willard. Hermit, hunter, trapper, gum and ginseng digger, passed on to the beautiful spirit world when he stopped breathing. He was a funny old jigger, but the game always dropped when he pulled the trigger. Now his old bones are smoldering in the sand while his spirit roams the happy land, where the sun always shines with its golden, golden glory. And that's Ginseng Willard, who will be appearing in another book. I asked Tim Matz, I had gone to Guildhall trying to find Ginseng's epitaph to see if that was actually there. And in true to form, anything that has to do with the North Country, the Northeast Kingdom, or Northern Maine, you can't get there from here. And the way Tim Matson described this to me is, well, you have to find the cemetery, and there's a cypress tree, and if you line yourself up with a cypress tree and a barn and a hex on the barn, you're going to find Willard's stone in the ground. Now, this is predicated on knowing that I know what a cypress tree looks like. Thank God we have one in our yard in New Jersey. So I went into every cemetery in Guildhall has a cypress tree. And so I went in every cemetery, and then I had to look for this barn with the hex sign. Well, the barn and the hex sign, they're gone. But by poking around, I finally found old ginseng stone, and there it is, and there's grass grown over it, and he never did get his epitaph carved in stone, but at least he's got it put in into spiked boots. Now, I want to know how many of you here have grandchildren? Okay, now if you have grandchildren, I'm going to make an assumption that means your children are still alive. Right? I'm going to ask you to think about this when you become 88 years old. If some of you have it, you know, that's still a ways off for all of you, I'm sure. Uncle Harl was the fair-haired, the bright, and capable son in the Pike family, and he had several brothers and a couple of sisters. And he didn't marry until late in life, and he didn't have his own children, and he worked on the Maine Railroad. And I think that some of the earliest stories my father ever heard came from Uncle Harl. And in 1963, a couple of years after the hardback copy of Spike Boots turned out, Uncle Harl was 88 years old. My father turned 58. And I was touched when I found this letter. I had no idea that any of my great uncle's letters had survived. He barely graduated eighth grade before he went to work. And when the time came, my grandparents called him back from working on the railroad to work the Pike Farm in Waterford, Vermont. And so he basically had to manage his other siblings. My own grandfather took off after his wife died and left two orphan children. And so my great aunt Julia took in my aunt Elizabeth, and Uncle Harl took in Dad, and so Dad was raised by his grandparents and his uncle. And I was really touched to read this, and I wanted to share this with you in particular because maybe someday you'll want to write this to your own children if you're 88. It says, "Dear Robert and family, I love you all. Wish you lived nearer by so I could see you and see my little boy in my old age that I enjoyed as I did when he was 5 years old, and those were the happy days, for he was entrusted in my care. Everyone said I would spoil him. Well, I'll say the environment was the best. But happy birthday to you. I'm proud of all that I made of the boy that was entrusted to my care." It's just a really simple letter. My father wasn't a terribly demonstrative man, and Uncle Harl loved children, and I thought that, you know, at 88, sometimes you don't have it all together. And to just say this in a really simple fashion spoke volumes, and Dad dedicated Spike Boots to Uncle Harl out of his love and respect for him. And so when you see that picture of the three of us in the foreword, if you think of that, if you think of your own kids, and let them know that you're proud of them, okay? Just think of that in terms of Bob Pike. One of the other letters I came across was from a great dame who turns out to have been the granddaughter of G.E. Henry. And if you know your history about the log drives, the two great rivals were George Van Dyke and G.E. Henry. And this is the first time, apparently, that she wrote, that Kate Benedict wrote my father. She says, "Dear Mr. Pike, I have been highly entertained by your book Spike Boots and envy your fund of anecdote and experience in the North Country. I took Spike Boots along to Clearwater, Florida this spring on a visit to my cousin, James Averill Henry, who is currently writing a memoir of the family, just for our use only. We were much interested in your chapter on George Van Dyke, since he and GE had been partners in various lumber enterprises in the 1880s, specifically the so-called New Zealand tract near Fabian's." And so, she goes on, gives a little background, and then she proceeds to say, story on page 27 is not a George Van Dyke story, it's a G.E. Henry story. The story about Van Dyke's death, according to the Henry version, Van Dyke was the one who released the brake and his car went over the cliff and he died as a result of his injuries. And she proceeds to pick this apart in terms of recasting history in the Henry family annals of what went on in lumbering here in the North Country. And then I get to the very last paragraph where she says, "We spent long happy hours over the martinis arguing whether Vern was real or not." And so I thought, I wonder how many other martinis there might have been over arguing the fine points over whether it was George Van Dyke or James Henry who was the fiercer lumberman. When George Van Dyke died, he was probably worth somewhere in the vicinity of, I think maybe about $5 million. Henry, if you've been over to the mills in Lincoln, you're familiar with he made millions of dollars that left his family very well cared for in subsequent generations. But Kate was a Radcliffe graduate. She's a petite woman, tailor-made clothing. She came here to the Gould Academy. And at this point, by 1968, my father had been carrying on 8 years worth of correspondence with a woman he had never laid eyes on. And after the crowd had cleared somewhat, and there were maybe about 20 people left in the auditorium, this little woman, dressed completely in black, with a pillbox hat with a veil, comes sauntering down the aisle as though she owned the building. She probably had enough money that she could have owned the building. And she points at my father and she says, "I know that rascal." And my mother blanched. And the minute he heard the words come out of her mouth, without even knowing what she sounded like, he knew that it was Kate Benedict. And it was thanks to Kate Benedict that Tall Trees came to the attention of W.W. Norton and Company and got published. And so she was here as much to celebrate in this event as she was to finally introduce herself. Her son was an editor at W.W. Norton. And she spent all of her time driving around these woods here, reacquainting herself with all kinds of people and doing some history. And she typed out letters copiously to my father, including one where she chastises Dad. My father was not a businessman at all. He just loved to write and just wanted to get it out there. And thank God he had a day job teaching. She said, "Incidentally, if I had a little gold mine like Spike Boots, I wouldn't start sending checks back." And then apparently my father agonized over whether or not he should take out advertising. This was for the hardcover edition of Spike Boots. And she says, "What's wrong with paid advertising? Don't tell me, I know, but let's stick to the subject. That is to say, how will the interested reader know of it unless he is informed? And since newspaper readers hardly rate as readers, they move their eyes, that's all, except of course for the New York Times, I suggest working the relevant periodicals, like the Saturday Review, Field and Stream, Outdoor Life, Yankee. You'll know the others that either carry book advertising or tangential to the subject. Up boots, and have some more fun with it." God, I can only imagine what she was going to be married to. Okay, there's some other things. I'm going to read you another story from here, and then I'll take some questions If you have any, or if there are any other things that you'd want to comment on. Stan said that you might, some of you might want to share some of, if you have met my dad, and I'd love to hear these stories because I do collect them. Feel free to. But this is one story. I gave a talk up in the Northern Forest Heritage Park up in Berlin in May, and a man came up afterwards, and I had met him a number of years ago, and he has a camp up in Milan. Apparently he's had this camp for as long as my father has been alive, and my father's trying to make a go at being a writer, but the man couldn't understand how my father could be writing, since every day he'd come over and knock on his camp door with his fishing rod and be asked to take him fishing. And so here we are, and we're here on Lake Averill Lake in northern Vermont, near Norton. The lake trout I almost caught was the high point of the trip. I had rowed out into the lake after supper to watch the sunset and to practice fly casting. I was the most surprised fly caster in the world when the 20 pounds, oh, he must have at least weighed 20 pounds, of gray furry grabbed the fly. He hooked himself hard and fast, and there we were with a lake in a lake 300 feet deep and a couple of miles long to maneuver in. I thought I was going to need all of that room, for with his first rush, he went over 50 yards straight away from the boat, and then the line shot off the bobbin along the pole as though an elephant had hold of it. Then he turned and headed back just as fast as he had to the left. And I reeled in with all my might, desperately wondering what kind of whale I had hooked, and prayed fervently that he wouldn't get away. The creature kept rushing back and forth like that, scaring me every time, lest all the line should run out, and then it would have been goodbye. If I had had a heavier rig, it would have been easy. I could have let him tow me up in front of the camp and then yelled to Sam to come out and brain him with the axe. But I couldn't do that, so I sat there in the boat and thanked the Lord that it was a steady old scow. The skin wore off my thumb, and my arms were aching, and my heart was thumping at a merry pace. And then Mr. Fish began to vary his straight rushes with a little horseplay. He would come in quite close and then begin to run in circles. The rod bent double, and it was the devil's own job to keep the line taut. It had grown dark, and I was becoming exhausted. My arms were trembling violently, and I could hardly reel in properly. But luckily, the big trout wasn't so frisky as he had been either. About the time I was quivering with fatigue and my thumb was so painful that I was thinking of quitting in shameful despair, the trout meanwhile skulking 50 feet away in the darkness, a canoe came silently up beside me. It was Sam and Vern, and they had a net in that canoe. My courage rose greatly, but alas, prematurely. For though Sam got the trout in the net and even lifted him out of the water, he was too anxious, and consequently he slipped and nearly overturned the canoe. There came a mighty splash in the darkness, accompanied by a mighty oath, and that was the end of my laker. And before we all get bitten by these bugs, I'll entertain some questions in it if you have any, or comments. Well, good. Yes, I'm sorry. Please. Thank you. The museum of the Bethel Historical Society sells his book.
Okay.
These are very well told true stories. Thank you. One of his best narrative books is a children's book on General John Starr called Fighting Yankee, and that's out of print. And I've read from that in the past. Also, what struck me was, and this was probably when my dad was married to his first wife, and he had a period of where he didn't have to teach. And it's a completely fluid stream of writing from beginning to end, and I think he probably also had a wonderful editor. I explained to people that Spike Boots is like the bedside companion to Tall Trees, Tough Men. The people for whom logging is everything, you read Tall Trees, Tough Men. You want to read about teamsters and rum runners and river drivers and bounty hunters, you're going to read Spike Boots. It's subtitled The Sketches of the North Country. And that's exactly what they are sketches of people. And some of the things that they did that were legal and some of the things that they did that were illegal. And there's some romance thrown in and there's some naughty language. They're all individual chapters, yes. They're all profiles of people. But Vern Davison, who used to work at my great uncle's farm, he chose as the narrator to tell this story. Yes.
What age?
He started writing poetry, believe it or not, when he was very young, when my grandmother was still alive. And he probably, he was the first in his family to graduate from high school. And he tracked down some of his classmates and the littles in high school. And his Dartmouth reunion, the 75th reunion was this October, and I hope to go to that. But he's been writing these stories now since since the beginning. He's always wanted to do it, but coming from a farm family, writers, it's not a profession that gets a lot of encouragement. And it's certainly not for the faint of heart. I earn a living as a writer, and you have to have courage and convictions to do this. And when Yankee reissued the previous edition of this in 1987, I drove my father to all of his book signings, and there was a point where he turned to me, and he just could not believe. There were people lined up in these bookstores, out onto the sidewalk, to meet him, to get him to sign this book. And then they bought old copies. They bought the original copies of Spike Boots. They bought his first epitaph book called Granite Laughter and Marble Tears. I mean, these things are put in people's wills. When we did the Concord Vermont Historical Society, there's a man named Quimby that came down, and he said, you signed this to my grandfather, and he put it in his will that I would get it, and I want you to sign it to me, but I'll also buy a new book. But he wanted that genealogy noted in that copy of Spike Boots, that it went from grandfather to grandson, and that Bob Pike signed it 40 years later. There, the woman who runs Echo, Len, up on Second Connecticut Lake, I met her several years ago when I was on assignment for the Boston Herald, and she said she doesn't loan these books out anymore, that she keeps them under lock and key. And the lady in the striped shirt back here, I'm sorry I don't remember your name.
Becky
Carroll. she loaned one out and never got it back, so she had to buy another one. and that's just, beyond that, this strikes a chord with people, and there are other writers who have written who aren't as famous as Howard Mosher that are struck by the way my father's written or by these stories, and he caught these people at the right time. And even though the publishing world didn't want them, because after World War II, the publishing world in America was only interested in fiction and full-length novels. So they didn't want the stuff that Stephen Crane and Washington Irving turned out, those sketches. And this is Spike Boots is definitely in that vein. There was not a publisher that would touch that. But he really believed in this book. And as a kid, when I was four, my parents sold this out of the trunk of the car. The summer I turned 4 years old, those first copies. And I say this in the foreword. I mean, my father, no salesman. I mean, he's clearly the academic. He's like the riverman in Florsheim wingtip shoes. He'd say, here, you'll want to buy this book because your name is in it. And that would be it. The concept of advertising just wasn't it. He just really believed in these stories, and he really believed people would want to read them. And they still do. I met a woman this morning when I was up at the Northern Forest Heritage Park who said, oh my God, I'm so glad you're here. Somebody recommended these books, and I'm going to buy both of them. Yahoo! Yes, I'm working on a book right now for Rutgers University Press called Readings from New Jersey. And then I have several other book proposals. So, yeah. I'm not giving...
I wrote one thing and I was rejected by 26 people. That was the last thing I ever wrote.
Well, you never know about that 27th. They say...
Please contact us again.
It takes a lot, it takes support, I think the other thing that I tell people that want to write is that my father enjoyed his greatest success as a writer when he was married to his third wife, who was my mother. And it was the most stable period of my father's life, and I still live in that house. And I think that writers need that stability just to be able to, for all that creativity to come out. And for years, if my father wasn't the sound of his typewriter, he was the sound of coming in and telling these bedtime stories when he'd come back from teaching night school. And my mother, would urge him in French to go in there and talk to me, just tell me a story, any story at all. And so it was these stories that were in Spike Boots, and some of them were in Tall Trees. And then coming up here, because we'd spend every summer up here in August after summer school was over with, we'd sing these songs. about, you know, 15 men on a dead man's chest, yo-ho-ho, and a bottle of rum. And at the Northern, I'm going to spare Stan and the membership this, but at the Northern Forest Heritage Park, I had them singing in on the song about the little piggy cried and cried. Yeah, and nobody knows any of these songs. I had this repository of doggerel that nobody can tell me where they came from, and yet I learned these in a car driving up here, and it was only here. We never sang them in New Jersey. We only sang them here. So we have a cemetery song. We must have at least 12 different drinking songs. We've got songs about Dan Bossie and George Van Dyke. I mean, it just goes on. You know. And so, you're welcome.
I want you to ask the question you asked me about